CEO de Coursera, a quien damos la más cordial bienvenida. Invitamos a José Escamilla, director de Tech Labs y presidente del comité organizador del Cuarto Congreso Internacional de Innovación Educativa, quien será nuestro entrevistador. Veamos un video con su semblanza.
Jeff Maggioncalda, CEO de Coursera. Antes de su ingreso a Coursera, Maggioncalda trabajó durante 18 años como CEO fundador de Financial Engines Inc., una compañía cofundada por William Sharp, economista y ganador del Premio Nobel. Financial Engines creció rápidamente bajo el liderazgo de Jeff, proporcionando consejos de inversión en línea de alta calidad que ha ayudado a personas a ahorrar y prepararse para la jubilación. Jeff también ha trabajado como consultor en McKinsey & Company y Corner Store Research y continúa sirviendo como director de Silicon Valley Bank, Inc. Tiene un MBA de Stanford Graduate School of Business y una licenciatura en Economía e Inglés de la Universidad de Stanford. Bienvenido, Jeff Maggioncalda.
Jeff, welcome to Monterey.
Thank you.
After one day here.
Thank you.
We're going to have a conversation with Jeff, and we're going to take some questions from the audience in a while, after 10, 15 minutes. So be prepared to raise your hands, and we'll give you the microphone, and we will ask you to have small questions, not long questions, so that we can take advantage of the time we have here. So let's start this conversation, Jeff.
Yeah.
You've been here for two days in Monterey?
One day.
Okay, tell us how you transitioned from the financial world to education, and what are the similarities, differences? What have you learned?
Yeah, at my last company, at Financial Engines, we started a company that was, it came from two professors at Stanford, one of whom got a Nobel Prize in economics, and had developed a lot of thinking around investing. And we started a company to help Americans invest for retirement. We have something called a 401k plan, where you invest your money for retirement. And our idea was to use the internet so that we could make investment advice very personalized and low cost and accessible to everybody. And for 18 years, I was the CEO, and it ended up going, it was very successful. But as I looked at the problem of retirement in America, I realized that one of the big challenges was not just investing the money, but how can you help people save money for their future? And what we realized is a lot of people didn't have the job and the income that could allow them to save for their future. And so I was thinking about investing the money that people had saved, but I was really focusing more on how can you help people make more money. And a lot of that comes down to jobs, and a lot of that comes down to skills, and a lot of that comes down to education. Mm-hmm. So even at Financial Engines, I realized that education is the main solution to many, many problems in the world. And I always wanted to do education. I always wanted to be a teacher. And so when the opportunity to become the CEO of Coursera came along, and the idea that across the world we could help everybody get access to the best universities in the world for free in many cases, I thought that would be the best opportunity that I could have. And it's very similar, trying to use technology to create access for everybody in the world to get the best educations possible.
I remember that you told me that you were like, I don't know, 2 years sabbatical traveling around the world with your wife when you received this invitation to Coursera.
Yeah.
Can you share with the public? I find that very interesting.
Well, yeah, so I was very lucky. When I graduated from school, I was 27 years old, and I was the first employee of this company. And it's a startup company, so that you don't make much money. They give you a lot of stock options, but not much money. And so if you can build a good company, then financially it works out well. But for 18 years, I worked really, really hard. And I didn't have a chance to travel. And I had I have three daughters. And when I started at Financial Engines, one of them was five, and one was two, and one was not yet born. The other one was born 1 year when I was 28 years old. So I had three little babies, and I was trying to get this company started, and I didn't have time to travel, and I didn't have the money to travel. So when I finished at Financial Engines, my wife said, let's travel around the world. And so we went to Africa, we went to Asia, we went to Europe, we came to Peru, we went up the Amazon River. We did so many wonderful things, and we met so many people, and we learned so much about different cultures. And now I'm encouraging my daughters, you know, go abroad, live in other countries. Like Salvador said yesterday, he said the important part of education is to see the world and to not think that everybody in the world is like you and is like your culture. And that's a good thing, not a bad thing. And you can learn so much from other people.
Great. You, how long have you been in Coursera? Like 7 months?
Or? 6 months.
6 months already?
6 months, yes.
Okay. And now that you've been 6 months in Coursera, how you can describe Coursera like in one word, in one tweet?
You know, I think that we want to make it the world's learning platform, the place where everyone comes to learn. And it really has three pieces. It has learners, which is individuals. Today we have 30 million individuals who come to Coursera to learn. We have 150 universities in Latin America. We have 11 Latin American partners. We have many in Europe. We have many in Asia. We have many in North America. So we have 150 universities and 2,400 courses. And recently, in the last year, we've been starting to sell Coursera to employers, because employers are realizing that the world is changing very quickly. And there were some great presentations I've seen here about how the need for different skills is changing. And when people graduate from college, they'll have to continue to learn for the rest of their lives, because the world is changing and skill needs are changing. And ultimately, people will need to be getting an education for their whole lives. So Coursera is trying to help everybody, learners and educators and employers, all work together to keep the world well educated.
Great. So compared to 2012, I think that was the year of the MOOC.
Yes.
And some president said the tsunami is coming.
Uh-huh.
Am I right? That makes a transition from what Coursera wanted to be in 2012 to today. And how have been that transition?
Yeah, I think that the first big wave was kind of the MOOC wave, where universities took their courses and they filmed videos and they made these courses available at very, very massive scale to millions and millions of people, in many cases for free. And so it's largely videos, and you could download them onto your phone. So many of our learners, I think almost 50% of our learners in Mexico, we have 1.4 million learners in Mexico, many of them download the courses onto their phone, and they can watch them if they're on their bus, they watch them if they're stuck in traffic, they can watch them at home, but they can get education from Tec de Monterrey and UNAM and many great universities on their phone wherever they are. So the first big wave was MOOCs. I think there are two next big waves. One is Coursera in the workplace, where employers are hiring Coursera to help their employees get educated. And the nice thing about that is when employees get educated at work, it helps them get better jobs. It helps them get more raises. It helps them get the skills to get promoted. And I think that's important. And then the next major wave, too, will be not only taking the MOOC courses, but now we have, with some of our university partners, full master's degrees online. So that you can get a diploma from the University of Illinois, you can get an MBA, you can get a master's in computer science, purely online, and you can do it at just a fraction of the cost. So I think another major wave will be more and more courses and degrees being offered online.
Great. So Coursera has been there for more than 5 years, has more than 30,000 learners or students. 30 million learners. There's more zeros there. More than 2,000 courses, more than 150 universities.
Yes, uh-huh.
And you have this huge amount of data in your databases that come from all those universities and all those learners. Mm-hmm. Can you share with us what you have learned of how people learn in Coursera?
Yeah. Well, one of the things to point out is that scientists and researchers are learning a lot more about how people learn. And one of the things I'd recommend to everybody, if you want to try Coursera, one of our most popular courses and it's among the top 10 most popular courses in Mexico, is a course called Learning How to Learn. And it's a neuroscientist who actually teaches people how their brains work and how you can learn more quickly. So there's been a lot of science around learning, and now, as you said, with all these learners, we have a lot of data on how people learn. And one of the things that we've been doing is we've been sharing with our university partners, how can you construct courses that help more people complete the course and learn the material? And some of the things that are probably pretty obvious to most people, it's common sense, is to say, you know, start off at the right level of difficulty. If people try to start a course and it's much too difficult, they give up. And they, you know, it's not worth their time. So starting at the right level is key. Finding courses that people are interested in is very important. So among the top courses in Mexico, we have personal finance is a very popular course in Mexico. And accounting, for whatever reason, accounting is a popular course. Psychological first aid is one of the most popular courses. A course on robotics that's among the top 10. So I think it's wonderful that learners pick classes that they're interested in. They're much more likely to complete them. And then in terms of how you actually build the courses, what we do is we have a course, and usually it takes about a month to get through the course, about 11 hours. But we break that into smaller pieces. So a course is made up of modules, usually three modules, and a module is made up of lessons, usually about four lessons. And a lesson is made up of very small videos of 5 minutes each. So making sure that people can get small, bite-sized pieces of content and learning, and over time they can build a set of understanding that's very big, but they do it in small steps that's easier to manage. That's another big part of making courses more attractive to learners. Okay.
Have you made some studies that allow to compare the learning behavior online and offline or face-to-face?
You know, we have one of the things about learning offline that's very convenient is that people can go at their own pace. We actually have a feature on the videos where you can speed up the video. So, you know, the lecturer is talking at a certain speed, but if you want, you can make it go 50% faster or you can make it go twice as fast. So some people like to learn very quickly. Some people like to sit down for many hours, and some people like to sit down for just a few minutes at a time. One of the nice things about online is that you can go at your own pace. When you go to university, my youngest daughter is just started at Duke. And she, growing up, so she had an iPhone when she was in high school, and she did a lot of online courses in high school. And she got to Duke, and she said, "Dad, this doesn't make any sense. There's a course I have to take, but it's only available on Friday morning at 8 o'clock in the morning." And she said, "I don't want to wake up at 8 o'clock on Friday morning. I'd like to just take the course when I want to." And I think that's going to be a big part of the online method. Now, what happens on campus is very valuable, though, is the engagement and the collaboration with other students and collaboration engagement with the instructor. So most MOOCs do not allow you to engage with the instructor. And you do engage with other learners through discussion forums, but it's not as personal as what you get on campus. So what we've been doing with our degrees programs that we've been working on is actually doing live interactive video so that the professor is actually teaching hundreds of students who are all online with video conferencing. And we have integrated group chat so that the whole class is chatting, and then study groups are all chatting with each other. And then the study groups also have video conferencing just among each other. So there's live interactive video, audio, and chat during these sessions. So I'd say wave one in 2012, the MOOCs did not have very much collaboration, but we're moving to a world where even online, you'll get the same kind of collaboration that you can get when you're on campus.
Okay. There have been some criticism because MOOCs give the possibility of delivering education to lots of people, but the rates of termination are small compared to traditional education, in the order of what, 6% or something, something like that. Can you share a little bit your, what's your explanation of that?
It really depends. So if you think about how many people complete something, a course? It really depends. So the highest rates of completion are among our degree students. So when someone joins our degree program, we have about 2,000 students now taking master's degrees on Coursera from University of Illinois and HEC Business School in Paris. Those completion rates are over 90%. So when a student says, I'm going to get a master's degree, and they pay for the master's at University of Illinois, it's about $20,000. So they're paying a lot of money, and they've really committed to it. The completion rates are very, very high. If you look at completion rates among our courses where people pay for the course to get the certificate, completion rates are above 50%, so much higher. If you look at some of the free courses where someone comes on, they just kind of want to check it out, the completion rates could be much lower, sometimes 10%, sometimes lower than 10%. But if you look inside the course and you see, among the people that started this part of the course, just this module or just this lesson, you see much higher completion rates. So I do think that sometimes when people come to a MOOC and they're not paying and they just want to check it out and experiment, kind of see what this is about and maybe I'll like it, they're just checking it out. They're just browsing. It's like if you were on Amazon, do you buy everything that you look at? No. Sometimes you look and you research. You say, do I want this or do I want this? I want to read a little bit about this and I'll decide not to buy this. This one I'll put in my shopping cart, but it's on my wish list. So I think in the early stages, people won't always complete it. They'll try it, and maybe they'll come back to it. It is interesting, when you look at the people in our degree program, 45% of them have come from free courses. So they start with the course. They might not even finish the course, but they say, you know, I'm interested in this. I'm going to get a degree in this. And so I think that's the way it's going to work, is at the course level, many people will try it. They won't all complete, but many of them will decide, I'm going to really learn about this, and I'm going to take more advanced courses, and I'm going to perhaps even earn a degree in this topic.
Okay, so the analogy is like when you go to a library and you browse a book,
yes.
And then you decide to take it or you leave it there.
Yes.
And what are the things that Coursera is doing to make more people take that book?
Yes.
What are the services or the options you're offering to the students?
I think a lot of it actually is helping them understand what benefit they will get if they take the course. And so we're trying to show more data, not only about the course, but like with Uber, when you get out of the car and you do a star rating to say, was this driver polite, was he safe? We do the same thing with courses. So every course has a course rating where individuals can rate the courses. So helping learners see what other learners thought about a course will help them decide, do I want to take this course or not? Being a little bit more clear about what will you learn if you take this course. So other learners who have taken this course have said that they've learned these things will also be helpful. But a major next effort is to help link the courses not only to the skills that you might get by taking the course, but by the jobs you might get from taking the course. Because a lot of people are very busy, their lives are very busy, and they're really thinking, what can I learn to help my career? And I think by linking some of the courses to the career benefits, it will help people stick with the courses. And what we found, we do a survey of people who complete courses. And in Mexico, among individuals who were taking courses to improve their career, 94% of the ones that completed the course said, this helped my career. I think we need to do a better job of explaining to people up front how taking this course might improve your career.
A while ago, you were talking about mobile.
Yes.
And in Mexico and most of Latin America, emerging countries also, mobile is more important than landlines.
Yes.
No?
Okay. Yep.
I know that you have made a lot of effort and investment on your mobile platform.
Yeah.
What are the results of that? What can we do mobile and desktop, and what can still not do yet?
Yeah.
Well.
Well, it is extraordinary. I've done, since I've been here, probably 8 press interviews. And I noticed, too, when we had our panel that you moderated with the provost, there were many reporters. And I was watching the reporters. Almost all of them were taking notes on their phones, you know, not with pencils and paper. The younger, all my daughters take everything on their phones. Yeah, I know. Yeah, I have the same thing. But the younger people, you know, they'll do it on their phones. And so, when you look at the taking notes on the phones, recording on the phones, taking videos on the phones, taking pictures on the phones. The phones are becoming an amazing platform for communication. Now, the screen is a little bit small, so you have to be thoughtful about how you design it. But like you said, we've invested a tremendous amount in mobile technology. And so what we allow professors to do, many professors record their courses on their mobile phones. So it's not always in a studio. All the courses are available on mobile phones. We've also created a feature because we know that many people in developing countries, and certainly in Latin America, they don't want to use all their data plans. They're going to be doing the courses on their phones, but they don't want to use their data plans. So they can download all the videos onto their phone when they're on Wi-Fi, and then watch it offline, so they're not using up data. And when you think about collaboration with two-way video, even just out here, when I've been walking around, people have been having video conversations with their friends and with their colleagues and with their family. I mean, people are communicating over video with phones all the time. So you say, why couldn't you do large classrooms with interactive live video with students, with study groups, with TAs, and with professors all on phones? And that's available today, right now. Our degree students are having the full interactive experience on their phones. So I think you will not need computers and landlines to do full, high quality, high engagement, higher education.
Okay. So if I understood you, there are some courses in Coursera that have been recorded by professors on their phones.
Yes.
And I'm amazed about that because sometimes we think that to do a good video for a course, we need a studio.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So what have been the results of those courses, and have you seen if there is some kind of secret sauce or recipe, even if you use a phone or a camera, to have a good video?
Yeah, this is one where I think that professors, many people will say that universities are out of touch, that universities are teaching knowledge that is not so relevant for careers and jobs. But universities are very good at teaching. They understand that there's a sequence of things that you need to learn, and you build on other principles. So the best courses are not the ones with the best production values. The best courses are usually ones that are taught very clearly. It does help if the professor is funny, if the professor has passion for what they're teaching, if the professor develops a relationship with the student, that helps quite a bit. But we've had professors who film the courses on their phones, and we've also, we now have courses where professors do live interaction with hundreds of students. Sometimes they will do the live sessions from their phone as well. They'll mount their phone on a tripod and they'll sit there with their computer and they'll give classes to hundreds of students, and they're being broadcast live off of their phone and they're using their computer to moderate of classes of 500 people, all video, all live.
So you say passion, interaction, and
humor.
And humor. Okay, I'll take note of that for my courses. So I think that also the same thing that we see in regular classes when you do that is very, very similar.
And you know, one of the things that we hear professors say is that when they teach classes on campus, because they're in a physical room and the students are sitting in great lecture halls of 500 people, there's not much interactivity during the lecture between the professor and the students. It's broadcast. It's one way. I'm speaking, you're listening. That's it. But when you're online and you are broadcasting via video and it's two-way video, you will do a little bit of lecturing and then you'll ask some questions. And then people will show up on the screens. And then what can happen is the professor can hit a button and immediately 500 people will be broken out into 100 groups of five, and they can have discussions among just five students. And these five students can be in five different countries. So you have students around the world talking face to face with each other about a topic that the professor is talking about. And when they're finished discussing it, they'll come back and report to the professor in this live forum what they've just discussed. So in many cases, the engagement between the professor and the students is higher when they're using technology, even than when they're on campus and they're sitting in the same room, because the communication technology allows them to have more interactive experiences.
Great.
I think there's, this is a good moment to take a question from you. There's anyone here that want to ask something? Raise your hand. Yep, Ulises, there's a microphone, please.
Thank you very much for sharing the knowledge with us. The first question would be, in terms of entrepreneurship, uh-huh. what are the hottest opportunities or challenges that you foresee for the next 10 years in edtech technologies?
Okay, well, there's entrepreneurship in general, then there's entrepreneurship within edtech, and I can probably be more intelligent about the first one. I'll give you a chance on edtech. But I'm pretty new to EdTech, so it might not be as good. I think with respect to entrepreneurship, I'm on the board of directors of Silicon Valley Bank. And Silicon Valley Bank is a bank that lends money to not only startup companies around the world, but also to venture capitalists who fund those startup companies. And they're always looking at trends in entrepreneurship. And one of the things that we have learned about entrepreneurship that has changed very much since when I started Financial Engines in 1996 is the cost of starting a business is much, much lower. And that makes it much easier for entrepreneurs to start a business without raising a lot of money. And so to start a company takes much less money, and there's open source software. So you can get MySQL, you can get very low cost hosting on the cloud. There are digital marketing platforms with Google and others that are very low cost. So companies can get started much more quickly with much less capital. But what's interesting, if you look at the investments that are going into the growth companies, like Coursera has raised over $200 million. Which, when I was at Financial Engines, we raised $150 million, and I thought that that was a lot, but Coursera has raised $200 million. So you say, well, this doesn't make any sense. If it costs less money to start a company, why are companies, the successful ones, raising so much more money? And I think what that has to do with is distribution. So it's easier to start a company and to come up with a product and to develop a prototype of that product and iterate it and find customers that say, yeah, I really like that product. But now there are so many choices in the world for how someone could spend their dollars or spend their time that getting their attention is very difficult. And if you look at people's attention, it's being not monopolized. It is being concentrated in Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter, Google, sometimes LinkedIn. There were a few really big networks, including Netflix, including HBO, that are really taking up people's attention. And so to start a company, one of the hard things is getting people's attention. And so companies don't raise much money anymore to start the company. They raise a lot more money to grow the company because marketing is important in a world where a few big companies kind of own big networks. And if you're not in that network, it's very hard to get distribution. So that's probably a long answer to the general entrepreneurship question. Now, how would you solve that? One of the things I would say is, start small and find an audience that you know better than anybody else, and then build off of that. Don't try to go to the whole world at once. It costs too much money. In EdTech, one of the things I've realized already is that there's a huge difference between K through 12 and adult learning. And it's really tricky, but in K through 12, when you think about education, the way that I thought about it when I was at Financial Engines is when children are very young, what they mostly need is adults who love them. They need eye contact, they need someone to touch them, they need to have other kids that they can play with. It's much more parental teaching and then social teaching. All the way through middle school, a lot of it's still you're learning math, you're learning language, but a lot of it is social. As you become an adult, it becomes a lot less social. The trick, though, is that when you're young, what you're learning doesn't turn into a job that someone will pay you for. So it's like, well, how do we get money to teach the kids? How do we get money to teach the middle school? How do we get money to teach the high school? Because they're not getting jobs where they can immediately get a job to pay for their education. Someone has to pay for it, whether it's their parents or whether it's the government. And if they don't get a good fundamental education in K through 12, things like Coursera will not be so valuable because they won't have the basic understanding and education to take advantage of these resources that Tech de Monterrey and some of the best universities in the world offer. If you don't have the foundation, you can't even begin to appreciate it. So I think in EdTech, there's a big difference between K through 12 and adult learning. And K through 12 is really going to have to do a lot with partnership, I think, between universities, well, between educators and governments. And I think in adult learning, it's going to be partnerships between universities and employers. And so I think that's a very different mix between collaborating for young people between schools and the government and for adults between schools and employers.
Thanks for the answer. We got another question. Go ahead.
I take my professional certificate maintenance courses online with Plan Edison. Mm-hmm. And I also have designed testing in community colleges. I think it would be very interesting to the Latin American audience to expand on professional certifications and courses to credit maintenance, and also for professional testing for licenses like truck drivers and all of those elements. Could you share that with your thoughts on that with the audience? Thank you.
Yes. Excellent point. So when we launched Coursera, I wasn't there, but when Coursera was launched by Daphne and Andrew in 2012, it was a lot of it was about content, making content from the best universities available to the world. And that attracted many people. But especially for adults who are thinking about, I want to learn this, but it's not so much the content, it's what I learn and how that helps my career that matters more. Where there's a really important step between the skills and the career, which we call credentials. And one of the most valuable credentials and one of the most traditional credentials is the college degree. So that's kind of the super credential for most of the world. But what's happening now, mostly with online education, is that these credentials that are degrees that are 4 years, they can be very expensive, they take a long time, and relatively small portions of people get them. I think in Mexico, I want to say 19% of the adult population gets a university degree. I think in the US it's like 44%. But it's not even half, even in America, it's not even half the people that get that full degree. They're expensive and they take a long time. But what's happening with online education is these credentials are getting broken into smaller pieces. And so you don't need to get the whole credential, you can get parts of a credential. So people are calling these micro-credentials. With our degrees that we have right now with University of Illinois, there's an MBA, but the MBA is composed of 4 different certificates. And if you don't want to get a whole MBA, you can pay 1/4 of the price, and in 1/4 of the time, you can get a credential just in digital marketing, not the whole MBA. Now you can get that credential in digital marketing, and if you like it, later you can get the MBA. So you could do one piece of it now, have a credential that will help you get a better job, and then if you want to, you can get that full degree later. So we're seeing degrees get broken up into smaller pieces and offered in smaller pieces. But another thing that we're seeing, so we have a certificate in project management. We are starting on Coursera to offer many credentials that are not just university degrees. And what's interesting is we now have 20 content partners who are not universities, they're industry partners. So Google is a content partner on Coursera. And Google has created a certification called Google Cloud Developer. So if you don't want to get a full master's degree in computer science, you can take this set of courses that Google authored, you can learn how to become a cloud developer, you sit for a proctored test, and then you get a credential that says, I am a Google Cloud Developer, and you can show that to an employer, and they will hire you if what they're looking for is cloud developers. We are about to launch with Google in January something called a Google IT Specialist. So Google has created a program for people who do not have master's degrees and they do not have bachelor's degrees. For individuals who do not want to get a college degree or can't afford to spend the time to get a college degree and have no education in computer science whatsoever, they can take the Google IT certification and become an IT professional on Coursera without having to get a university degree at all. And I think that the world is going to be full of these smaller credentials, so people can earn their way up to the big degree, but it's not either you get a degree or you have nothing. You can build your way to a degree over your lifetime.
So on this conference yesterday, we saw Amar Kumar saying that the future of learning will be tied to the future of work.
Yes.
So by 2030, the work scene will change a lot. But some of the trends that we have seen are micro-credentials, yep, nano degrees, stuff like that. But also on the discussion yesterday, Kerry Helly and I think that also Pablo Navas from Universidad de los Andes talk about the importance of liberal arts, of humanities, as we say in Spanish. Some people criticize that those micro-credentials because they say that they humanize the learning, that doesn't create like better citizens. That's one part of the goals that we universities think that, yes, we do. What do you think that will happen with that trends if we go in full operation of those micro-credentials and we leave out those things like liberal arts or humanities?
Yeah, I heard Kerry talk about the analogy of the tree where the roots are liberal arts and then the trunk is some of those STEM skills. And then the skills that you learn, they change over time. And I think that's a really good analogy. My background, when I went to a Jesuit high school, and I really loved English. And when I went to Stanford, I was going to be an English major. And my dad, my freshman year, my dad found out that I was going to be an English major, and he said, I'm not going to pay for your degree. If you're an English major, I will not pay for your degree. Because you can't get a job as an English major. So I got another degree in economics. I said, fine. But I also was an English major because I love English. But I think what's going to happen, this is just my personal belief, is it would be nice if everybody could do liberal arts education before getting their first job. But for many people, that's not an economic reality. And many people don't go to college at all. In fact, there's a survey I was just reading that in Mexico, 8 out of 10 people who do not have a university credential say that the major reason is cost. In other words, they have to be able to provide for their families. If it's the case that the way to start providing for my family is to get a micro-credential, and at least that gets me a job as an IT technician, that's better than not going to school at all. And I think what's going to happen, and there was a great presentation here from Pearson when they looked at the skills of the future, and it was not data science and computer science. It was collaboration and creativity and leadership and influencing, a lot of these soft skills that are developed when you have
psychology,
a liberal psychology, how people think, right? I mean, if you think about your cell phone, right? If someone said 20 years ago that everyone would have a cell phone, and therefore everybody knows how to program, and everybody knows has to know how video cameras work, and everybody knows how to do lean manufacturing, and everybody has to know about global supply chain management, because that's what it takes to make a cell phone. You say, no, I don't need to understand all the technology to do my job. This is just a tool. I think there's something very true about the enduring nature of liberal arts, because fundamentally technology that is successful gets productized in ways that's available to everybody, and not everybody has to know how to do it. So my view is that in many cases these micro-credentials will be pretty applied and they'll be pretty professionally oriented, but if you want to advance in your career, learning those soft skills and getting that liberal arts education might be an important part of becoming a manager or becoming an executive in a company. It might flip upside down. Maybe instead of doing the liberal arts education first and then trying to earn your applied computer science degree, maybe you actually start by learning some of these micro-credentials to get into the workplace, and then as you want to rise up in your career, mm-hmm, you start rounding it out with more of an understanding of these soft skills. I don't know, but that's possible. What I will say, though, is getting some education is better than getting no education, and many people can't afford to spend 4 years getting a liberal arts education if that's not going to help them get a job.
Okay. Thank you. We have another question.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
What are your challenges and your aims in terms of rural communities? How are you planning to reach more and more underdeveloped communities where they don't have internet, but they need training, education, and through that we could empower them?
Yeah, I think that it's really tricky. I don't see a world, well, I say I don't world, I don't think for a very long time that Coursera will be able to provide instruction without an internet connection. That doesn't mean that Coursera can't help other people who would provide education without an internet connection. When I was in Uganda, as I traveled around, I was very interested in education and other things, and I met a CEO of a bike company. And this bike company had a program to offer bicycles to people in rural African communities. And the reason that and this was part of an educational effort. You say, well, how could a bicycle be part of an educational effort? Well, the rural communities were so spread out that one of the biggest obstacles to getting to school, because they didn't have an internet connection, they had to go to school to learn, is it was too far. So they had a bike program so that people could get to school from farther away. I think where Coursera might be able to help is by providing teacher education so that teachers could get access to the best educational courses and how to be a teacher. In the States, Chicago has now made it mandatory that every high school student must take a course in computer science before they can graduate from high school. The problem is the teachers in Chicago high schools don't know how to teach computer science. So to really teach the kids, you need to first teach the teachers. And I think that where Coursera might be able to help is teaching the teachers what they need to know to teach the students. And ultimately, I do think that mobile phones and internet, whether that's delivered through balloons or whether that's delivered through satellites, that there will be ways that rural communities get the internet. But I do think that in almost every instance, getting high-quality education in a fast-changing world will require an internet connection. That being said, K through 6, when you're in kindergarten through 6th grade, you don't need the internet. You know, you don't need the internet to learn your letters, to learn how to treat your friends in school. It's more as you get older and you start needed to be learning more advanced concepts that you need the internet. So for young children don't need the internet, I don't think. But as you get older, you do. And I think that phones will be a major source of getting that more adult education as we go forward.
Okay, thank you. We have 3 minutes left, so I will ask you two questions in these 3 minutes. Can you tell us what's the difference of the learners that come from Mexico and Latin America? We have many people from different Latin American countries here, compared to those of other emerging countries like India, for instance, or developed countries like the United States or Europe.
Yeah, so there are a few things. I mentioned that Mexico has 1.4 million learners. It's growing. Mexico is growing faster than every other country in Latin America on Coursera. What we've noticed about the top courses, as I kind of mentioned, they are very wide-ranging. So it's not just business, it's not just data science. There are many courses on personal development that Mexican learners seem to take. There are many more courses on entrepreneurship. So 1 in 5 learners in Mexico who are on Coursera say that they're doing it to start a business. Okay. 1 in 5 are saying they're doing it to start a business.
Can you tell us something about the demographics of the students?
Well, so the students, there are more female in Mexico than broadly. So in Mexico, I think it's 48% of the learners in Mexico are female. 44% of the learners globally are female. So there are slightly more female learners. And when we ask the question among people who are taking Coursera to help their business, to help their careers, we find, especially among women, 98% of the women on Coursera who complete courses say that it helps their careers. So there's more, I think there's more on entrepreneurship, there's more on balanced and well-rounded personal development, and there's more of a tilt towards female learners in Mexico than the rest of the world.
Okay. I will be glad to have you here several times, but what if we invite you in 2022, 5 years from now, and we are here on the 12th of December doing one fireside chat.
Fireside chat, yes.
Once again. And I ask you, what the story that you would like to tell me about Coursera of the next 5 years?
Yeah,
what would be the story?
So I have been inspired coming here. I had breakfast this morning with Pablo from Uniandes, and he said something that I really loved. He said, Jeff, one of the most disruptive ideas in higher education is collaboration. And I thought that that was wonderful, because we have 150 university partners. They're all using Coursera individually. And many of our learners are using Coursera individually. And many of the businesses are buying Coursera for their employees. But I hope that 5 years from now, when I come, I say that the biggest difference between now and 5 years ago, 5 years from now, is collaboration. I hope that I can say that many universities are actually collaborating with each other on Coursera to offer education to tens of millions of people, not 1 million people, and that employers in industry are collaborating with universities like Tech de Monterrey, and they are jointly creating courses. The university is creating the more foundational knowledge, and the employer is creating custom projects to apply that knowledge for their businesses, so that you see collaboration among universities, you see collaboration between universities and industry. That's what I hope we could say 5 years from now.
Well, I hope you realize your dream.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Jeff.
Yeah, thanks, Pepe.
Thank you.